All right. Well, blowing through the agenda here. I'm sorry this is taking me a while to put together, but as Kim said earlier, better late than never. And I'm really glad that we took a few months and looked at each kind of stage in the pipeline process for when business owners came into us together. And I took all of your feedback and some of Kim's feedback and put together a new pilot for how we do the interview process with a shorter form and some more like hand-holdable resources. So I'm gonna show you that right now and encourage you to stop me if you have questions or say, hey, that's terrible. Don't do it that way, whatever. Whatever you need to say, but I would love to sort of share some of that with you. I sent you the PDFs this morning. I have like everything open. I sent you the PDFs this morning, but if you look on the agenda, you'll see a link to the workbook in Google Drive, which I'm pulling up now. So just to back up a little bit, what I had heard from y'all was that when you go through the really long interview, A, it's too long. B, it like turns people off to call it an interview. So it's an initial client meeting. And that you don't need all of that information in your first session. You need things to talk to people about afterwards. And it's too hard having the questions and the context all in one form that lasts forever. So does that sound like what you said pretty much from folks? Yes. So in this, and actually I might pull it up as the PDF, you could see all of the information in this guide, but let me pull it up as the PDFs because I think that that may be easier to see. Nope, not this one. All right, initial, so the first link on, so the first sheet in the workbook is this page, which is the initial short meeting guide. And instead of whatever, 30 questions, we're shooting for 20-ish minutes, and there are 12 questions. So take a look at this when you have time. And this first sheet is the question, and then on the side, it's context and nuances to be aware of. So things you might want to bring up if it comes in conversation, things you might want to explain, things that, and all of this, it's been added and edited, but kind of just some context, things you might want to do as you do the interview. The second form in the sheet is that same one without the context. It's just a place for responses. So you can print this out, you can write on it if you want to, or you can just copy and paste the whole workbook and, you know, edit it and type them in as you'd like to. So those are the first two sheets. The one has the context and nuances. The second one just has a blank form, so you can just bring it if you're going to the client's place of business. Hopefully that's a little bit clearer to see and look through. The third sheet is the first follow-up call that you might make. So instead of asking all of these questions all at the same time in the first interview like we were doing, the first follow-up call sheet, it's really a guide. You know, the first interview, you probably want to kind of follow along to the sheet. This one, it'll really depend a little bit more on the business owner, but we did two follow-up call options. One, if they have employees. So this is focused on learning more about their employees, trying to sort of guide them to consider whether or not their employees could take it over and dive into the resources they might need for that. Or a second follow-up call with no employees. So that's more focused on sell sheets, how to talk about your business, if they have competitors in the region that might be willing to take over. And so this has the questions and the possible discussion and resources kind of on the side here a little bit. These are mostly discussion questions and a guide. Again, you don't have to follow it verbatim, but it just gives you a nice guide to be able to say, okay, we had that first initial call. Here are some things that I can follow up with them about and ask them some more questions in our next meeting. And this is the thing I'm most excited about, I'm not gonna lie. We have like 70 videos available. No, that's not true, but there's like 50 videos available online now. And all of these resources that we've all put together over the last 3-4 years. And it's been really hard for me. It's getting to a point where it's even hard for me to be able to be like, oh, you asked this question. Let me dig through and figure out which resource will be the best for you. So the last, one of the last sheets on that, the in the workbook is, okay, here, they need general North Country information. All right, send them the guidebook. There's the link to the guidebook. There's the link to the website. They need an introduction to the transition process. Here's an 8-minute overview video. Here's the workshop series video that's most recent and probably the easiest to like get that information. Business valuation, general education. Here's a bunch of videos that are available that touch on that. Here's some, if they're a large company, here's some formal valuation supports. So business valuation, there's really three options, four options, right? One is just sending them the general education. The first like one-on-one support option is if you helping them to develop, to fill out all of their sheets and then those bringing them to this, them bringing those to the CPA. And so that has some information about that. Business valuation one-on-one support is you could send them to the SBDC. I made a little note that said not all the agents are trained in this. So as their liaison, please follow up to ensure they're getting the support that they need, right? So you have more than one option about business valuation. And so they're kind of all divided up here. Business valuation group or cohort support. If you have the time and you have more than one person who needs valuation support, it's time to do a working group. All of the trainer sessions are on this playlist here. So you can link back to those at any time if you need to refresh yourself and it's time to do a new working group. And I linked in the past working group that Kim did in from 21 to 22. So you can check those out. That's helpful. And the playlist for our train the trainer will be here and we'll continually update that. If they need support in transitioning to an employee or family, the videos for their tax considerations and taking over a business, information about CBIT to send to an employee or an aspiring entrepreneur who wants to take over. A lot of the times the business owner might ask about, oh, so-and-so wants to take over, what can you send them? There's some stuff to get them started. Support in transitioning to worker-owned cooperative, videos, the people to send them to, support in transitioning to a family member, videos, person to send them to, open market transitions and sell sheets, information there. Inspiring local success stories. Maybe you want to send them something to get them excited. Resources specific to taking over a North Country bed and breakfast. Almost forgot we did that. And the mediation resources, aspiring entrepreneurs, general information, and specific to farm and ag transitions, we have a whole series that you could send to farmers or ag folks. So this is a bunch of stuff that's in one workbook. You also have it in PDFs. It's also in the CBIT 2020 folder. Is from cursory glance, is this the kind of thing that you think will be helpful? And is that kind of what you were looking for a more streamlined process? I see some nods. Any concerns or anything you didn't see that you were thinking might be helpful that could be added?
Not specific to the forms. I think the forms seem good. I had popped in the chat, and I don't know if everyone recalls, we had that gentleman come and do business evaluations. He did like, you know, multiple in different communities. Is there a possibility for that to occur again? I kind of almost feel like, I mean, obviously we're here to help and guide them and do as much as we can, but sometimes the businesses for that particular piece, it's almost like, okay, I need a professional to come in and evaluate this. So is there an option to do that again? Is there an option for us, for the business to pay for someone to come in to do that?
Let me know if that's a thing that you need. I put it in a bunch of grants that we have out the door and it would be included hopefully, and in some of the money would be set aside in some of our sponsorship money too. Okay. So, As it stands right now, we don't have like a particular bucket of money for that right this second. But if you get them started and it's looking pretty good and you need Kim to come in and look at everything that's done and give it a, and Kim, yeah. I'm raising your hand, but tell me if you don't have time for that. And then right now we'll see if Kim can look it over once you've gotten them that far. And then hopefully we'll be able to get some additional funding for a outside person to continue. Okay.
Yeah, the last time we talked. Sorry, go ahead, Kim.
No, sorry. That is kind of the idea, is that you work with the sellers, use their P&Ls to populate that valuation workbook. And then we work together, you, me, and the client, to create the valuation.
I would say, yeah, because you and I had talked about, like, you know, us doing our initial, like, working group and introductions and trainings, and then have you kind of come in and talk about a little bit more in depth the P&L. I just think, too, that they see that it's not just their chamber person. It's a group of people that they have access to. I think it's important.
Yeah. So the last presentation today, we're going to go through sell sheets, letters of intent, and financing that you can present. The last presentation that I need to package to make and put the presentation notes together and everything is the valuation one, to get you guys up to speed so that you can talk valuation at a high level with your clients. You can start the process of populating that workbook. And then, as I said, then I kind of step in once that work is done and help you do the valuation and kind of validate the valuation to make sure it works for both the seller and the buyer. So hopefully you're starting to feel comfortable with that content at this point. And then with that last presentation and the presentation notes, hopefully you will feel comfortable presenting that. And then the idea kind of is that we've talked about a little bit is with the working groups, you present the content, and then there may be questions that come up that you don't feel comfortable answering. And then I maybe jump on in the last 10 minutes, you know, 10, 15 minutes to answer any questions that people have that you guys didn't feel comfortable answering, or maybe you didn't feel like you answered quite comprehensively enough.
Great. Thank you. So if you want to copy that Google Sheet workbook for yourself and then use it, and you can make it your own, just don't, I think it's only view only, so you can, you should be able to copy it and make it your own. Just don't write in the original one. Thank you. And if you still want to do the long interview form, that's fine. I didn't change the Google form or any of the other stuff. Or if you want it, but we're just going to try this to the end of the year, and at December's quick fire meeting, which will probably be at the beginning of January, we will review this and see how it's going for folks. Like, is the short form and the new forms working for you? If so, then we'll change the automation process to reflect these particular documents. Cool. We're also, there's this kind of links to, like, okay, here's the information that they're asking for. Here's some likely videos that might be helpful, but it is not a sort of clear, it is not a full video directory of all the things that are available. And one of our staff members is working on that, and I'll get that to you in the next 2 weeks. Okay, we already talked quite a bit about our sellers working groups, and at the very bottom of your sheet, the agenda today, you'll see that there is, you know, what everybody said they were gonna do and when, and there's a link to a spreadsheet of when all the different programs are. So if somebody can't do the dates and times that you have and somebody else is doing a hybrid one or virtual, send them to someone else. Don't let them fall off the radar. Get them in a working group. Once we have everybody's like information cleaned up a little bit, we'll send this out to you in a nicer format, but it's never too early to be like, oh, you can't do ours. That's okay. Let me take a look. Hamilton County is doing theirs completely virtually. We'll get you into that one. Those dates work better for you. Great. Make sure we don't lose people that way. And just a quick reminder that the sort of incentive to get folks in these groups are really about they can participate in the conference and we can highlight their business in the conference when it comes up in February. Does anybody need anything additional from us to be able to start promoting or developing that working group at this moment that you need to make sure you highlight or let us know while we're on the line?
Danny, did you want to go over the material that you all put together to market the program? Are there links to that stuff in here?
They're not links in here. I will add the links in to the materials that I sent along in an email. So it'll take me a minute to find all that, but I'll add the links in here so you have it. Add links for marketing.
Just so it's all in one place and people can access it. Because perfect.
Great points. And just a reminder, you don't have to use that stuff. feel free to make your own. Just stick the CBIT logo on it somewhere. Don't care. Just get it out there. just trying to make it easier. It sometimes makes it harder. I don't know what people's preferences are. we had a few folks come in recently. Oh, sorry. I'm going to take another beat. Does anybody need anything for their working groups that we can help you with right now? Going once. Going twice. Going three times, sold to the next agenda item. If you need more humans for your working groups, are you having a hard time finding some people? we have a few folks who don't have liaisons because they're in a county or place that does not have liaison representation. If any of these businesses sound familiar to you, or you are interested in just getting some extra ones and adding them into your portfolio, Bonnie and Clyde's Gourmet, A&B Classics, Lapland Lake, Tradesman Contracting, there are all of the marinas. Matt, Carol, and I need to have a conversation about this. Matt, your entire working group may just be marinas at this point. so we'll talk about that. And then Evergreen Auto and Saranac Lake. Rachel, that was a referral that I just got the other day. We got a follow up with, but I haven't sent it to you yet. I don't know who Valerie Aldis is, but she called me and I just wrote it on here so I didn't lose her, but I didn't do anything about it yet. And then Mitchell Stone and Lumber in Tupper Lake. Rachel, would that be one that you would mind following up with?
Sure. Yeah, I can do that if you send me their contact info.
Okay. And that's a little bit of an, I guess, public enough that somebody who told somebody else, but he didn't reach out to us directly. So we can just beat around the bush a little bit until we get there. so if anyone wants to talk to me about that or have anything to say about some of those businesses that are out in the ether, does anybody have any thoughts or feelings about that?
You know, Jenny, and this just kind of, I know we don't have a lot of traction, I feel like, in Clinton County.
Yeah, some of these are Clinton County, which is why they end up, because we don't have it.
And I know it's in part because we have a arm's length relationship with the North Country Chamber, but it would be interesting to see if we could get on their agenda. Anyway, let's see what we can do there, because I feel like we're just not getting the, anyway, never mind. Another conversation for another time.
Great conversation. I would love them to be liaisons. I've been trying so hard for 4 years.
Or at least refer up to us and we can help, you know, those businesses, because.
I'm hoping maybe we've had a lot more success in the last year getting the North Country Chamber to like co-sponsor and work with us on events. So I'm wondering if the conference might be a good way to get them excited and into that, to connect in that in a tangible way. So love to talk about that more. Great. Okay. We've got talking about the conference. Rachel, do you want to kick us off with just like basic overhead information about what's going on there?
Sure. So working on getting some quotes from our two larger hotels for some potential reception, Sunday evening reception spots, Saranac Waterfront Lodge and Hotel Saranac. And I have all the information from Hotel Saranac, which is, I think, would be a great location. They're also gonna do a room block and offer discounted rooms for anybody who wants to stay overnight. And also has meeting space, can do lunch, can do breakfast. So I just need to, Danny, touch base with you, I think, and see where we're at with a budget on what we want to book, but we're pretty much ready to do that. I think that's kind of it for, I'm still waiting to hear back from the Waterfront Lodge, but.
Great. Working on a number of different avenues for sponsorship and grants, et cetera, to finance both the conference and CBIT for the next year. And I know, Matt, you said your team wanted to talk about that a little bit more, and Jenna wanted to talk about help more with that too. So we'll follow up with a call sometime in the next couple weeks with a larger group to talk about the conference. But in the meantime, let's do a fun activity. Let's do a fun activity.
All right. Danny, I got to check out.
Okay, thanks, Steve. Talk to you soon. All right, so on, so you could see this on my screen, but you can open it on yours in the chat, which is the Jamboard. There's a Jamboard. You should be able to do whatever you want in there. And so we're trying to look at the agenda for the conference. This year, it'll be a little bit different in that we will have three tracks. So folks can choose from a variety of options for why they're attending and then have educational opportunities related to their reasons. One, for folks who have already taken over a business. We have a cohort of folks who have already taken over a business and may want to learn more or engage. We're gonna have a cohort of folks who don't know which business or region, like really don't know where they want, they're really just starting out, don't have an idea yet. And then we'll do more for them to promote the whole region and different kinds of businesses and a wide scope. And then we'll do a track of folks who have the business that they would like to take over in mind, right? I'm going to take over the business I work at, or I'm already talking to so-and-so. So it's more getting into the nitty-gritty. So on the Jamboard, you can open it in the chat. If you want to take a and the link is there in the chat. If you want to take stars, these are all of the, on the first slide here, it says what should stay. So these are all of the different programs we did for the last conference. So use as many stars as you want. And you could say, yeah, we want to redo that program. That's really awesome. That really was a great one. Definitely important to have in the next iteration. And on the second sheet is ideas for new topics. So we'll give everybody, you know, 8 minutes or so to six, 8 minutes to just kind of add in what they want to add in, put stars next to the things that they're excited about, add new topics into the second board. And if you have an issue with the Jamboard, it's just like, can't figure out how to use it. That's okay. Just write it in the chat, write your thoughts in the chat. But just give you a few minutes to think and work on that. I'll play some fun tunes and, We'll go from there. Is it too early in the morning for Patty Smith? It might be. Yeah. Hold on. We'll do this.
You guys don't forget there's the second page where you can make suggestions around courses or options.
When your mama, you want to do is cry. Now we end up taking the long way home, looking on the crest wearing buckets of stale cologne. So hard to see streets on the country road when your glass is in the garbage and your continental just been towed. Gonna take your mama out all night, yeah, we'll show her what it's all about. Get a jacked up phone, some cheap champagne, we'll let the good times all roll out. All right.
Great, thank you so much, everybody. Let me keep sharing, but we'll do a quick round. Anything that you wanna say as you were looking at these that you had thoughts about or things you wanna make sure you see? Laura, do you have anything you wanna talk about in terms of the conference, in terms of topics or anything that you put on there you wanna share?
I don't know enough about it to speak intelligently, so I'm going to keep my mouth shut.
No. You know what people need. Matt, how about you? Anything you want to add or speak to while we have a minute?
I added something to the board about basically... Obviously, the whole conference is about getting people to take over businesses, but let's really highlight why the North Country is your best choice.
Great point.
And whether that's part of like an overall introduction or a wrap-up session or whatever, but I think focusing on not only the business side, but the quality of life side and why we're the choice for your investment.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more, Matt, because as we've seen, like 2/3 of business buyers are actually from outside the area. And we have so much to our region is such an asset and such a strength that I couldn't agree more that that's. Yeah, huge.
Rachel, thoughts?
I had one thought around a new topic, but I couldn't quite put it into words well, but I was thinking about something around like an introduction to permits required or, you know, like, I don't know, overview of who to contact or things to consider in terms of permits and certificates needed. And or initial steps to take in thinking about LLC partnerships, those kinds of things.
Great. Rochelle, what do you got? Anything you want to talk about?
I think it kind of goes hand in hand with the moving to the North Country topic, but I added on the other page, like the realities of running a seasonal business and the struggles of finding help. And I think a lot of people don't realize how seasonal our businesses are, at least here in Hamilton County, and the huge swing of people that we get in the different seasons.
And maybe best practices around how to manage that. Right, the realities of it, and here's what you can do to be successful given that we have those realities.
And that's the same for St. Lawrence County sometimes, but because of all the college students, I would imagine it's a different kind of seasonality in some of those areas. Cool. All right, great. Well, this is good insight. Like I said, we'll get a date and time to move this forward a little bit. We'll have an agenda in the next 2 weeks and some places and stuff ready to market by the middle of October. So exciting that we're moving full steam ahead on that. Rachel and I are gonna meet tomorrow, I think, for a general meeting and have this on the agenda. So very exciting. And do folks want an 8-minute break before we jump in? We're going to do a scheduled partner reception. Let's go talk to Jenna. She's not here. So I will follow up with her about that. Do we want to take an 8-minute break before we get into the learning session, or do we want to just plow ahead?
A break.
Break. Okay. So let's come back together at anybody else? Good with that? Okay. So let's come back together at 10 and jump right into the learning session with Kim. Is that cool? Awesome.
And just to, as a little note, I sent the presentation out about 10 of 9. If you want to bring it up so that you can add notes to the notes section, feel free. I added notes, but often you'll hear things and you'll want to put those into the notes section. So
remind me of the conference dates again.
Yep. February 12th through 14th. Right, Rachel? I didn't make those up. Yeah.
I told you I'm not here, right?
Yeah, but we still get Aaron, right?
Yeah, we'll figure that out.
Don't panic. It's going to be okay. Aw. All right. I'll ask around, see if we know anybody who might want to jab with you, Matt.
Yeah. Any suggestions?
Cool. All right. We'll see y'all in a few.
Already 1 minute, and then we'll come back. Alrighty. Do we have everybody out there? Anybody out there? Laura's back, Rachel. Cool, we got Matt. Alrighty. Let's get going. You know what's very strange? Oh, there you go. Okay. So a couple of months ago, I gave you the kind of the 1 hour presentation on the whole process. And then we said we wanted to go a little bit deeper with valuation and kind of conceptually what that is and what business owners can do to increase the value of their business, understanding it. And then, as I mentioned earlier, the idea that you can start that process and then I can get involved to answer questions and do the actual valuation until you all feel comfortable and then do the validation. So they have a valuation for their business. And then the other pieces that are critical to a business owner being able to sell their business are having a sell sheet, kind of understanding the letter of intent. That's kind of the first part of the actually selling your business, and then financing options. And so this presentation is on those items. Sorry, I've just been a little buried. I will get you the valuation presentation. I'll put a video together. And then really leading up to your own sellers working groups, I would be more than happy kind of in October to do a Q&A session. So as you're getting ready to present that material, we could get on a call for an hour and you can just ask questions if you need clarification on certain aspects of the content and that kind of thing. I'll be more than happy to do that. If you go to up here, the notes pages, I have added notes. I know in the first one, I did actually a supplemental instructor's guide. And I realized that it's probably just easier to add the notes because when you go into present modes, then you can have those notes available to you right there. If you would prefer that I pull it out and in addition, put it into an instructor's guide, you know, if I have enough interest in that, I'd be happy to do that for you. So pop in the chat if you would prefer that or like that in addition, or if you think just having the notes as part of the PowerPoint presentation is enough. So I've added, this is just, you can pop your logo into the presentation and, you know, and very honestly, you all can do whatever you want with these presentations. This content you can use as is, you can edit it however you'd like, whatever will make it comfortable for you all to present. Similarly, you can write your own introduction to this particular module. This is the agenda, kind of this idea that, you know, they understand the big picture, they've done evaluation, or maybe that's a work in progress, but the items that they need in order to be able to go to market are the valuation, so they understand what the different components of their business are worth, and then the sell sheet, so that they can go to market, and then the idea that these other pieces are pretty important. This is just kind of where this is our, you know, graphic that we use an awful lot. And this is where the sell sheet falls in this, just in the picture. This idea, you know, and I kind of say, you know, business owners spend a ton of time marketing their business. And, you know, it could be email blasts and social media and this, that, and the next thing, but they haven't really spent a lot of time perhaps because they don't know around marketing their business. And this sell sheet will become the foundation of the marketing that they'll do for their business. It's very similar to a resume, which obviously most people are far more familiar with than a sell sheet, but it's essentially the same thing. It's a condensed version of the key assets and such that they want to use to sell their business. This idea that, you know, only 20% of businesses that go on the market actually sell, having a tight, awesome sell sheet will help, you know, market your business. It shows you're serious about selling. It helps you justify the valuation that you've established. And what we've heard time and time again is that those two pieces, the valuation for the business and then the sell sheet, really people are like, wow, now I really feel like I can move forward confidently and sell my business. So it's really getting folks over that is a huge, it gets them over kind of a mental hurdle. Again, this idea, a resume is not just a list of, it's not a list of job descriptions. It's a list of how you left a place better than you found it, like your key impact on the business. Similarly, a sell sheet is not every aspect of your business. You want it tight, you want it concise, and you want to use it in such a way that people are like, wow, I want to learn more about that business. So that's really important to me. And I want to reach out to the buyer. Again, yeah, there's a lot of information, and resist the edit, resist the temptation to just pack a bunch of stuff in that sell sheet. As a seller is creating their sell sheet, they would have thought about whether they want to market their business anonymously or kind of full disclosure, and they can edit the sell sheet accordingly. And we'll talk specifically about like when you have location and your business is truly unique, how do you give a sense of where the business is located without giving away the name of the business? If you have, like the example I use, if you have the only Vietnamese restaurant in Plattsburgh and you say Vietnamese restaurant in Plattsburgh, people are likely to know what we're talking about. Whereas if you say, I don't know, you probably even say Clinton County and people would know, but you kind of get where I'm going with that. This is kind of the general concept of the sell sheet, the different categories. You know, we'll walk through them. I'll show you an example of a sell sheet that is far more graphically sophisticated. And if you have that talent or you know someone with that talent, these are just the concepts that we want to get down here. The logo, you would want to swap out, you know, have them swap out their logo. And here we'll dig into the various elements. And I'm not going to spend a ton of time on this because it's fairly straightforward. And you guys, I think, are hopefully fairly comfortable. The headline, a lot of the marketing that sellers will do is going to be online. And it's that headline that is going to entice someone, a potential buyer, to click through and learn more about that business. And so you want that headline to be fairly inviting and graphic and specific. So these are some examples of okay to better headlines with more descriptors and opportunities to grow the business. And this slide builds, like it's you know, four slide, but it builds over time. So I just built it this way and you guys will see. The business location, important to note, as I mentioned, you can be vague or you could just describe, you know, college town in central New York or quaint village in Essex County, that kind of thing. The description, again, listing the products, the services, you're going to want to be as quantifiable as possible. Again, this idea that you're wanting to put the business's best foot forward, the strengths, the advantages, its uniqueness, and using lots and lots of great descriptors. Showcasing the opportunities. We'll talk a bit about the fact that business buyers want lots of opportunities that they can capitalize on. So here are some examples of those types of descriptors that you can use. You know, loyal staff, long-term staff, you know, really a loyal customer base, like lots of repeat customers. You're growing. It's example, I don't have to go through this in detail. Key financials, kind of, it's all over the map as to what you should include from a financial perspective. Some people say the more you financial information you include, the better off you are. Others say you don't want to include anything. The one thing that you do want to make sure that you include is something that gives a buyer a sense for the size of the business. So generally that would be kind of a revenue number, but coming up with a way, because you don't want somebody that has, you know, a $5,000 down payment being interested in a $5 million business, right? That just doesn't make sense. And folks, please, as I'm going through this, if you have questions, you know, either just come off mute, pop it in the chat, whatever. We will in the valuation section talk about the importance of understanding a seller understanding their walkaway price. And I'm just going to put it here because people don't appreciate that when they get into the heat, I kind of say the heat of battle because it kind of feels like that sometimes, where the buyer and seller are negotiating and it gets very emotional, and to not have thought through what your walkaway price is or your walkaway scenario, what it is you're willing to finance or not finance, your bottom line price ahead of time while you're kind of thinking clearly, it just makes it worse. So really kind of coaching them to understand, you know, what they're really hoping for, but then what is their the minimum that they would accept for their business? How much money down do they need? That kind of thing. The asking price is just the total price for the business. You know, you've worked with them. We've all worked together to establish the valuation, feel good about it. You want to start a little bit higher because negotiating is kind of this dance that you do. And everybody kind of wants to feel like they won a little bit. And so being able to concede a little bit on the price or different terms is important. And then what I say here, understanding what's most important. Yeah, negotiating, the more information that you have when negotiating about your buyer and what's important to the buyer helps you negotiate a deal that works for you. Revenue, that's a pretty straightforward. Couple little nuanced things. If the revenue has been relatively flat, you can include a three-year average. If the revenue has been increasing over the last several years, then you'll want to show that increase over time, right? By showing the different years. And if the revenue has been decreasing, you could, as I suggest, either include the most recent year's revenue or be a little bit vague and say it's in the mid 50s, it's in the mid 500s, or it's in the mid 100s or whatever. Sorry. I tried to pull out notes where I left when I copy slides. Disregard that. Cash flow in this sense is the seller's discretionary earnings that we've talked a lot about. It's all the financial benefit that the new owner will get for the business. I'm sorry, the financial benefits that the new owner would get out of the business. Seller's discretionary earnings and cash flow are somewhat synonymous. There you go, not unanimous. furniture, fixtures, and equipment, they would have learned about what that is and how it's valued during the valuation session. The same is true with inventory. You know, we'll talk about the fact that they would have learned about that. They can go back. And sometimes the value of these, sometimes it's in addition to the asking price. And here are some examples of what that looks like. And this slide builds over time. So here it's an actual listing out of BizBuySell. This shows, you probably can't see it, but when you go through this in presentation mode, you can see it shows the asking price. It shows kind of how much is assigned to the FF&E or inventory or the other way around. I can't read these. And then you can see here, it says either that those amounts are included in the price or they are in addition to the price. Same is true here. You know, what they are and the fact that they're included in the asking price. And I don't like, just as a note, there are transitions in these slides. And if you are not comfortable with transitions, this tab right here, hopefully you can see it's called transitions. You can pull all those transitions out. If you're like, ah, I hate the way these slides build, just let me know and I can help you edit those slides so that they're more to your style of presenting. Real estate, we've talked about the fact that the business will be valued separate from the real estate. The real estate will have a separate valuation from the business. Often owners will want to sell the business. No, maybe not always, but sometimes want to sell the business in addition to, I'm sorry, want to sell the real estate in addition to the business. Other times they won't want to hold on to the business. And the way that this is often presented here is a seller will say, I want $750 basically for my business. If you want the, I'm sorry, $750 including the real estate, down here you can say, if you just want the business, it's it's $150,000. And then they'll have a separate listing here where the business is listed for $150,000. And here it says, if you want to buy the business and the real estate, it's $750,000. So these are just examples of how you can market the business with the real estate or without the real estate. And those are on Biz Buy Sell. Here is an example of how you might be able to do it in our little, you know, sell sheet. So that you can do that. And that would be a conversation that you would have with the seller to understand what they want to do and how they're willing to move forward and that kind of thing. Employee information, just like, do you have what kind of combination of full-time, part-time? Do you have seasonality? Do you have contract workers? You know, what kind of benefits are you offering? Are there key people that are critical to the success of the business? If that's the fact, what are you doing to hold on to them to make sure that they transition to the new owner, things like that. Facilities, just describing what the facilities are. If you have a lease, is that lease transferable? Would it be renegotiated if it's transferred? Do you maintain the same? Things like that. Competition, like what other competition is in the area? What makes you unique? These are all fairly straightforward. Here are some examples of how business owners have listed the competition that they have. Again, just examples. And what I like to do when I do this is tell business owners, say, go to bizbuysell.com and check out different listings. See what like is compelling to you and what's not, and model your listing after what you find compelling and interesting and like, wow, that's a business that I would like to learn more about. The analogy that I use here, and I think you've heard it, like people that are buying a house, they go and they look around and they're like, wow, this house is really nice, but I would paint this room and I would blow that wall out and I would do all these things. Similarly, a business buyer wants to know about the different types of opportunities that there are to grow the business. And the more that a seller can do to articulate those opportunities for a prospective buyer, the better they are. And if they can even monetize those opportunities, like let's say in, I think my next slide I show, I think here it's a bridal shop, and they talk about if they were, because a lot of business owners, they get to a point and they're kind of out of gas and they're at half throttle, right? So maybe they used to have evening hours and they don't anymore, but here's an opportunity. If you were open to having evening hours, you know, you could say you would have, let's say, two more sales a week, and that would mean X amount more revenue per year, things like that. What kind of post-sale support? Obviously, new owner is going to need mentoring and shepherding and training and all kinds of things. And what is that going to look like? Sometimes an owner is willing to provide free support at a certain point. Sometimes it's negotiated that the seller stay on for a year as a paid employee, right? Doing whatever it is they do. And all of that gets negotiated. Area information, we talk about the fact that, you know, a lot of buyers are from outside the area. It was, we just discussed the importance of marketing the area and just selling people as much on the region and area as the business itself, and then make it easy for people to reach out. Obviously, if you're trying to market your business confidentially, having somebody call the shop and say, hey, I'm interested in talking to the owner about buying the business, that doesn't work. So whether they list their cell phone, perhaps you set up a separate email address that is just for the sale of the business. There are ways that you can market the business and have people reply and still maintain the anonymity of the business. We talk about the importance of vetting buyers, and a response to any marketing pieces can really be that first vetting of potential buyers. You can ask buyers, potential buyers, when they respond to the different marketing pieces, please tell me about what your down payment capability is. You know, a buyer with $10,000 is very different than a buyer with $100,000. The skills and experience of a potential buyer also have a key bearing on their potential success. And so asking them to list their skills and experience as it's relevant to the business is important. And pictures, really good pictures help. Again, kind of the anonymous thing. If your pictures are going to give away your business, you'll probably want to use either really close-up shots or there are stock photos that you can use. I can provide some guidance on that if you need it. So the examples, let's see what I have here. So here's what, cancel that. So this, Jenna actually put this really awesome sell sheet together using, I'm pretty sure she used, oh, good grief. What's the, whatever that like graphical.
Canva.
What's it? Canva. There we go. Yeah. Canva. She put this together. So, you know, it looks fabulous. Way better than the little template that I have. But if you don't have that skills, then you could go with, you know, with this approach, which is, again, using the template that we have there and inputting things. You know, here's the information about the contact information, you know, pictures. If you right click on these, it'll say like change picture. You can swap the images out. And these are actual images from a restaurant, but they're tight enough that it's not as likely to give the actual location away. So there are some sell sheets. I will email those to you, and then you can input them. Yeah, you can save them. And then if you don't know how, you can link to where they're saved so that they come up automatically if you want to be, you know, fancy like that.
Kim, can you also add those links right into the resource sheet in the workbook that we
have? Yeah, probably.
I put some in there, but they're probably not as good as the ones you, or as updated as the ones you.
Okay. Yeah. Let me make a note. Perfect. Okay. So, you know, you've marketed your business. You probably have, a seller has maybe had some conversations with some prospective buyers, and then someone is ready to move to the next level. And that often looks like a letter of intent. Sometimes a buyer and seller may have had start to have conversations around price and what's included and that kind of thing. But very often it will be the first exchange between a buyer and seller where they're actually discussing price and terms and that kind of thing. This might be an opportunity, like in terms of getting dialogue going. Have you ever been involved in a letter of intent? What is your experience? That kind of thing. And obviously, again, you all can edit these slides and interject your own chats or surveys or anything like that, that, you know, that suits your style and presentation. You know, the letter of intent, this concept that it's an initial non-binding agreement, it just, you want to make sure that you're on the same page before you move forward and engage with attorneys. You know, it costs a lot to engage with attorneys. You want to make sure that, again, you're on that same page. And you want to make sure that you're on the same page, because very often when you get to an agreed upon letter of intent, you enter into a period of exclusivity where the buyer agrees to not engage with, I'm sorry, the seller agrees to not engage with any other buyers during this period of exclusivity. And I think I include this in a minute, a little more on that. It lays out the next steps. The more that you and as, or sorry, that the seller and the buyer can kind of negotiate during the letter of intent portion, kind of the smoother it goes and generally the less expensive it goes, because you've really worked through conceptually what you're buying. Here's the list of things that are often included in that letter of intent. You know, what are you buying? The asset allocation, we'll talk about that a little bit more, but you know, how much are you paying for goodwill? How much are you paying for the furniture and fixtures and equipment? All of that gets spelled out. The payment terms, are you going to seek financing? Is the seller going to offer seller financing? If so, what are the terms? What does that look like? If there are accounts, if the any cash, accounts receivable, accounts payable, if any of that will transfer to the buyer, what does that look like? In this asset allocation, so what that means is that concept of goodwill, furniture, fixtures, and equipment, inventory, that kind of thing. Those items are taxed at different rates for the buyer and for the seller. The seller wants as much of that asset allocation taxed as capital gains, because the tax rate is lower. And it's very complicated. And so engaging, because there is like the type of legal entity, the depreciation schedule, like it's complicated. So you definitely want your seller to engage with their accountant so that they can understand how much they should negotiate, get put into goodwill versus inventory. Or, and unfortunately, what's good for the seller is not good for the buyer. And so I've done this a lot and I barely understand it. So it really is a conversation for the seller and their accountant to understand how they want to negotiate that. And similarly, the buyer is going to do the same. One good thing to know is seller financing that we'll talk about quite a bit is when somebody offers seller financing, it definitely reduces the tax impact because they're taking the gain over many, many years. So it keeps them out of that higher tax bracket. The timeline, you definitely want to include a timeline, especially for the seller, because the seller will be in that period of exclusivity where they won't be able to engage with another buyer while they are in that period of exclusivity. And so the buyer wants it to be long, because they want as much time as possible to go through the period of due diligence. That due diligence period is where the buyer takes a really deep dive into the business and wants to understand every aspect of the business, not just to understand if it's good financially, but also for the buyer to understand, like, is this the right business for me with my goals and objectives? So they want it to be long, the seller wants it to be short, and documenting it in the letter of intent is important. you know, who's going to write up the legal documents, like who's generally it's the buyer that writes it up, but it's spelled out here, like whose attorneys will draft it, you know, how long do you have, what do you need to do to get out of it. It's kind of, the letter of intent is non-binding. So because it's non-binding, you can always say like, I'm not going, but if there's the earnest money that's put down, like what would let you get out of it? The non-compete, there needs to be compensation for the non-compete because the seller is saying, I will not, like, for example, my bike shop, I had to agree that I would not start another bike shop within 50 miles for 5 years. And I was compensated for giving up that, the non-compete. So that's included there. And then, you know, are there prohibitive things that a seller can't do while they're in this? And then this little thing flies in here and it talks about earnest money. Earnest money is basically a deposit, and the amount is negotiated. It could be 1,000, it could be 20,000. The buyer and seller negotiated it. It doesn't always happen, but it signals this period of exclusivity, and it gets held in escrow by one of the attorneys, and it gets applied to the purchase price at the close. So financing, again, like this, the financing may have started sooner, but it's definitely going to start here where the buyer will look to secure financing. And certainly, you know, the seller is not the one that's getting the financing, but the more knowledgeable the seller can be on the financing and options and, you know, whether or not they're willing to offer seller financing, for them to have thought through all of that and be knowledgeable about it just means that it's likely that they'll be able to sell their business for more money in a shorter period of time. So, you know, here it's again kind of an opportunity to engage with your participants as what are the different options that are available for a buyer. I'm just going to check the chat here. Okay. Oh, a tag draft email. Okay. That's just Danny. Thank you very much, Danny. Whoops. What is that? So you started to vet, the seller has started to vet the buyer when they ask them to provide information about their down payment capabilities. When they sign the non-disclosure, the seller is going to open their books to the buyer. And similarly, the seller is going to ask the buyer to open up their books, if you will, to them, so that the seller can understand the financial credibility of the buyer, because how creditworthy the buyer is will dictate, you know, their likelihood to get traditional financing, or if the seller is going to need to offer seller financing. Just having a glimpse into the potential buyer's creditworthiness is super important. And again, it gets you that information that you need. Here are the different components that need to be financed. And this slide builds over time, but we have these different components of the business. Goodwill, we've talked about kind of at length. This is without question the toughest component of the business to get financing, because there's nothing there, right? Like there's nothing to put your arms around. There's no collateral. So that is one that traditional lenders or even economic development organizations are reluctant to fund goodwill. And that's very often where the seller will need to offer the seller financing. Again, this kind of builds. Inventory may be financed through traditional options. It may be through an economic development organization, that's EDO. You know, similarly with furniture, fixtures, and equipment. I have a deal going on right now where inventory and FF&E may actually be financed by the SBA, which is unusual, but it's happening that way. The other, you know, we talked about the fact that other could be patents that you have. It could be, you know, this really nice front end e-commerce site that you have. All of that, you would assign a value as well, and you would need to figure out how to finance. And working capital, you know, this is super important. And I often have a slide on this, but in the effort of trying to edit, you guys understand the importance of working capital and how our seasonal business is. You know, if through the winter months, if that's your off season, you need $50,000 to get through the winter months because, you know, your expenses are such and there's no revenue coming in. As a business owner, hopefully you save that through the summer, but a business buyer may be buying a business in the fall going into those winter months where they don't have that reserve. They need access, and that needs to be part of them buying the business, having access to that working capital so that they get through those winter months, and understanding how much that is important. And then the real estate, that might be separate. So here are the different financing options that are available. Kind of in hindsight, as I think about this, a pie chart is probably not the best graphic, but it's been working. So 99% of businesses have some, the 99 shows up somewhere when this builds. 99% of businesses have some component of cash that the buyer brings to the deal. It shows their skin in the game. Hopefully a buyer has been saving for some time, so they have that cash. It's a minimum of 20% if a buyer thinks that they're going to be able to get any sort of financing to finance the deal. It's very often traditional lenders will require even more than that 20% in order to lend. In addition to just saving over time, a buyer may have access to a home equity loan or line of credit. I did that when I bought my business. Generally lenders, and they actually are generally okay to do this because they can always repossess your house if you default on the loan. It can often be 80% of how much equity you have in your house. So what that means is if your house is worth $200,000, you have $100,000 in equity, meaning you're the principal, remaining principal on your home is $100,000, they would likely allow you to borrow up to $80,000. So that 80% of the $100,000 in equity that you have on your home. And it's a lot of people do it that way. And you can generally get a decent rate because of the equity of your house, securing that loan. You can borrow against your retirement. There are different rules and regulations and timeframes and that kind of thing. And certainly I know lots of buyers that borrow from friends and family, Aunt Mary. Now let's just talk about borrowing from more traditional types of institutions. While it's impossible for a lender to guarantee that they would be willing to fund a particular project, it is possible, and I'm working on a deal right now where it's happening, where the buyer, based on their credit worthiness, their net worth, their credit score, and the deal, the lender was willing to, and it's kind of anecdotal, but it's helpful to know, like, if a lender is like, well, you know, based on what I'm seeing, I'm somewhat confident that we would be willing to lend to this buyer, or like, hell no, that is not happening, in which case it's a non-starter. But having that conversation up front is really helpful just before you get too far down the line. So bank loans, you know, banks are willing to fund small businesses under very specific circumstances. The buyer has to have really good credit. as we know, banks are very conservative. The business has to have substantial assets, a good loan track record. The buyer has that substantial down payment. There needs to be a business plan that's really well thought out, and it definitely will slow down the process because the underwriting of banks and other credit unions and such takes time. Then we have the SBA. I am not going to lie, I've been doing this for a while, and I am aware of two businesses that, one, I know they got an SBA loan, and now I am working on one where they are hoping to get an SBA loan. I'm not sure why there aren't more, but there just aren't. The SBA works through local lenders to do it. If a local lender is like, this might be a good deal for the SBA, the local lender actually gets in touch with the SBA and asks them to guarantee the loan. These are kind of the different terms. Generally, it's a better rate. It actually, once everything is done, it happens fairly quickly, but you can see these rates, 2.25 and 2.75, they may have gone up slightly given the environment, the financial environment that we're at right now, but that's what they had been historically. So those are amazing rates, right? Like generally we're seeing 5% and 6%. These are just information about what they're willing to guarantee, the collateral needs, that kind of thing. Now we're moving on to you guys, the economic development organizations of the region. I don't think I have to go into a lot of this because you guys are pretty knowledgeable about that. And the fact that some of them have different loan funds, they target different things. Again, I'm pretty sure you guys know about this. The fact that these are some of our local EDOs, the fact that you have to have the buyer has to have a letter of declination, meaning that a traditional lender either isn't willing to finance them at all or is only willing to finance a particular portion of the deal. They're called gap lenders. You know, the application process often very similar to that of a traditional lender, that kind of thing. Then we go on to seller financing. 85 to 90% of small businesses are sold with some component of seller financing because of that goodwill option. This is actually a pretty good video. I will send you the link because for some reason it doesn't launch well, but it just, sometimes it's nice to break up the presentation and have somebody hear from somebody else that kind of substantiates the fact that seller financing is important and kind of what it does for the deal. And it, as I mentioned, often gets you a better purchase price because there's a larger pool of buyers. It speeds everything up. The seller can earn the interest. I think that's something that sellers often forget about is by being the bank for all or a portion of the sale, they get to earn that interest. Yes, it's higher risk, but there are a lot of benefits, and we'll talk through those. It's often for the goodwill, as we talked about, because the goodwill is hard to finance. It's often, a lot of the same. You're going to have terms. You're going to have an interest rate. The amount that a seller is willing to finance varies wildly from a very small portion to 100% of the deal. Often because of the risk involved, the interest rate is higher. The term for the seller financing, it can be shorter, it can be longer, and it is often this component of the deal that makes it work. And a seller may have gone into selling their business. They may start out at, I am not offering seller financing. And then they become aware of the realities of selling a small business. And they're like, all right, I'll sell my business, but I am only financing like X amount and I'm only holding paper for 2 years. And then they become aware of the realities of that and that it doesn't cash flow. So then they're like, all right, I'll hold paper for longer. And it really often becomes the component of the financing that makes the deal work for the buyer. And all of this, I know it, I'm like, I can help with this if you need my help as you become more comfortable with these aspects of it. They apply, the seller will ask to see a personal financial statement substantiated with documentation. So a buyer says, I have $100,000 in cash. They're going to want to see a bank statement with $100,000 in cash. You know, they're going to want that credit report that comes from Experian. They may want to see a resume, whatever other information a seller feels comfortable with. Maybe they want to see the business plan. Will there be, is the seller, I'm sorry, the buyer going to make major changes to the business that may change the viability of the business, things like that. Sometimes the buyer will need, you know, these are the different credit unions out there. They may have to pay, you know, but they, it's something that they need to do to give the seller confidence. The seller just needs to make sure that they're free to finance the various aspects. You definitely want professionals involved to draw up the legal documents that are involved. Without getting into the weeds here, there's a promissory note that outlines the different terms. We'll go through that in a minute. So here are some examples, and these are again out of bizbuysell.com, and just to show a seller ways that they can potentially offer seller financing. You know, here I'm, it's worth, I can't read these, but it's, you know, the business is 250,000. I'll do 100 of it for 2 years at 6%, you know, and what those different things look like. Sorry, this is another one where I forgot to take the notes out. So there are a number of legal documents that go along with seller financing. There's the security agreement that identifies the collateral that's going to secure the loan. What's a couple of good things to know for a seller is it is the buyer themselves, not the business, that will guarantee that seller financing. So if the business goes out of business, the buyer is still personally liable to pay back that loan. And they may pay $500 a month till the end of time, but you can get that money back. My recommendation is that buyers or sellers maybe squirrel away a little bit of money because they may have to pursue legal action if the business does go south. What I didn't know, and I found it somewhat comforting, is that with seller financing, it's not just a piece of paper. You know, you have all that legal documentation to substantiate it, but there's an actually a filing that is done with the Secretary of State. So it goes on public record that you have extended seller financing, and here is the documentation. The important thing for your seller to know is that they will be in a subordinate position behind any more traditional financing. And what that means is if the business doesn't succeed, those lenders will get paid back first before you would get paid back first. So that's just what first and second position mean. Here's just this information about the UCC filing. It's filed with the Secretary of State. It outlines the assets that are including. And it's just, I found it somewhat comforting knowing that that was there. An earnout, really quickly, not applicable in a lot of situations, but just being knowledgeable that this is an option, I think is helpful for buyers, particularly those buyers that have seen an increase in revenue over the last couple of years. And it can be used when the buyer and seller are not seeming to get to a win-win. And it's generally a pretty good thing for both the buyer and the seller. And it kind of works like this, where, you know, a seller wants $1 million for their business because the revenue has been increasing over the last several years. A seller is willing to offer this. So they're willing to offer $800,000, but then they're also willing to offer 50% of the profits until you hit that $200,000 so that the seller ultimately gets their $1 million. But it's done over time. And if the business doesn't continue to generate those profits, the buyer is protected. And again, it's, you're definitely going to want to get people involved. It's a little bit complicated, but I just wanted you to be aware so that you can perhaps guide your seller and buyer through that if that's an option. This is just an example of a sources and uses statement. I'm going to guess that many of you are familiar with them, but it just shows the different sources for financing a deal and how those sources will be used. And just like where the money is coming from and going to, and it can be dynamic because as a buyer is looking to finance their deal, maybe first it was going to be a bank and now it's going to be the seller. And but just being aware of kind of where the different money is coming from and going to just kind of keeps it clear. I'm a visual person and I think a lot of people are. And that's kind of it. So just like in closing, you know, you want a good sell sheet. The letter of intent is kind of the first thing you would want to negotiate. It, financing can take a lot of different forms, and seller financing will definitely help a lot in terms of getting your business sold. And then you guys can put in whatever your contact information is, your next steps, and that kind of thing. So questions, comments, like, holy cow. I'm really glad it was recorded because that's a lot of, I realize that it's a lot of information. The sell sheet is fairly straightforward. It's, you know, again, it's pretty straightforward. The financing piece is a little more, you're just going to want to be a little more comfortable with that content so that you can just kind of speak to it versus reading from the slides. But yeah, questions, comments, what do you think?
Well done from my perspective, Kim, from a lender's perspective. I think that's an excellent presentation you just put together, very spot on.
Okay, thanks, Carol. Are you guys that are going to present starting to feel like you have a level of confidence with the content? Are we like 25% there, 50% there?
Yeah, I feel like this slideshow that you put together makes a huge difference. And in terms of confidence and comfort with the material, this helps a lot. So thanks, Kim. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, wonderful. And as I said, right, like as we get towards, you know, I think Steve said his first presentation was late October, I'd be more than willing to get on a call. Like, as I said, I'll probably have one every couple of weeks, just kind of an open session where as you start to go through the material, it'll be like, wow, I don't remember what she said. I don't want to go back through the recording. An opportunity to again, right before you're going to present, get that level of confidence. Okay.
Sounds good.
Perfect. Without further ado, I will turn it back to Dani, see if she has any closing thoughts on this.
No, thank you so much for pulling all that together. And you have did you mention about the third session stuff that you'd send that out?
I will, yes, I will get that out to you, God willing, next week. I will do my best for next week. I can't at this point make guarantees, but I will do everything I can. And I will definitely make sure that it's out, if not next week, the week after. It's a quarter end, so I have to do a lot of invoicing and.
No problem. Cool. I just wanted folks to know what to expect.
Yeah.
But everybody enjoy those. I was going to say flowers, leaves, whatever you're doing. Have a great weekend and we'll talk to y'all soon.